So we're very fortunate to have Shantan Basu come back to CEDAR and tell us about some interesting recent developments on a long-standing interest of his, of the self-organization of stellar accretion systems.
Good way to put it.
For those of you who may not have met him before, he's one of CEDAR's great success stories. He feels even
at least a graduate.
After having completed his chairmanship of the at Western last July.
Yes.
And is now a free man.
Mm-hmm.
And without further ado.
Oh, thank you, Chris. Lovely introduction. Right. So when you get old and you're free, you come back to your old home. So good to be back here. It's a pleasure. And yes, I'll be talking about kind of an ongoing series of projects I've had over the last 9 years or so, summarizes a migrating embryo model, but also I'll be throwing in some of the latest work, certainly in the second half of the talk. Really, again, it's a pleasure to be here, and I'm going to, I have kind of a talk I have made, so some of this introduction is just way too simple for you guys, but let me just quickly get it out of the way. So we have a relatively successful model for disk evolution and planet formation and core accretion, and the beauty is its simplicity, and of course it's a model you can think of almost in an axisymmetric steady state manner. And you've got dust particles which coagulate to form planetesimals. Planetesimals form planets, and then you clear out the remaining dust and gas, and you throw out your objects to make Kuiper belts and Oort clouds and all that. So anyway, that's the standard picture, which is fine. But then some of the remaining issues, or ones I'll highlight, are number one being the timescale problem. Which is based on the observation that if you look at disk frequency around young stars, then as the age of the young stellar objects increases, the disk frequency drops quite dramatically by even 5 million years. And by 10 million years, it seems that disks are largely dispersed. And so that's quick. That's rapid. And so in comparison, of course, the standard original core accretion model, even Jupiter took at least 10 mega years to form, and Uranus and Neptune would have been longer. And of course, there are ways people have found to try and massage those numbers. But the time scale is one of the basic issues. Another interesting point is if you look at images of disks, even ones that are not particularly young, in some cases where you can mask out the central star and look at the scattered light, you often see spiral structure. And the new Subaru seed survey is actually seeing a lot of non-axisymmetric structures, certainly, in disks. And in many cases, it's spiral-like. So this is hinting at something happening that is perhaps more dynamic and certainly not axisymmetric than the standard.
Yes. What stage are these stars?
These, I think, about a million years. Okay. Yeah. Or even older in some cases.
So are these disks or
These are, I think these are actually protoplanetary disks. Yeah.
Gas ridge.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not sure if there are debris disks in the survey. There may be, but yeah. So these are. Yeah, I honestly don't know. And it is scattered light, so you need a model. You need a model to get that, because ultimately you're looking at what's coming off the surface of the disk. Okay. So another thing is exoplanets that are in wide orbits. Certainly now there's a fair number that are at many tens of AU from the central object, or central binary in this case. And so that these are, again, supportive of an idea that you could have had a direct gravitational instability to form these objects. Of course, we also know from jet observations for many years that there's episodic behavior. And to the extent that's tied to the accretion history, there is evidence that the accretion is happening in bursts just from the jet morphologies alone, as you see in HH30. But then, of course, variability is directly observed, the classic case being Fuori. So that had this very rapid one-year rise time. and it's been declining over decades, 70 years now, without yet having come back to its pre-outburst state. And what you know, just the zero order about F Eouris, is that they are objects that have some visible circumstellar matter. And if you convert many magnitudes luminosity increase into gravitational potential energy release, then you're talking about a three order of magnitude increase in the mass accretion rate, 3 to 4 orders. Okay, so variability is established very well in stellar accretion of young objects. And so at one point, Lee Hartman made a hand sketch of what might be happening just based on back-of-the-envelope estimates. And the estimate basically was, okay, we have these F Eouris objects that have been observed for the last 50 years at the time. And if you compare the number that have been seen with the expected number of YSOs within the visible region based on some low-mass star formation rate, then you would have actually expected to see a lot less than the couple dozen that have been observed up to that time. So there was kind of a factor 10 to 20 discrepancy. And so the idea is, well, perhaps every YSO undergoes 10 to 20 bursts during its early lifetime. And so he just drew this hand sketch of mass accretion rate going up and down into burst phases, and even made this connection that perhaps the bursts would be occurring during the time when you had significant envelope accretion onto the disk. And somehow that was leading to the bursts. And then when that went away, you might settle down to a more stable accretion phase. Another independent line of reasoning to get at variability is just through, again, source counts of a different manner. If you look at, and this is from the C2D survey of Spitzer, if you look at the distribution of bolometric luminosity versus temperature, so HR diagrams essentially, and convert bolometric luminosity to mass accretion rate, then the blue bar is about 2 times 10 to the minus 6, which is both a theoretical value from the Shu 1977 theory for 10 degree Kelvin gas accreting onto a central object, and it's also the empirical number that you would get for the average accretion rate onto these YSOs, taking a typical lifetime of these class 0 and 1 phases of 500,000 years, and a typical stellar mass of a half solar mass for these objects, divide one by the other, and voila, again, you have 10 to the minus 6. So the fact that you're not seeing the data points lined up along 10 to the minus 6, but you're seeing a larger number below and a smaller number above, is again consistent broadly with the idea of episodic accretion. Okay, so I'm going to say a little bit about our models. And so the quick animation that sums it up is that if you run simulations of disks as they're forming, where matter is still falling onto the disk, so the black region is not empty at this point, you will episodically drive the disk into instability. Gravitational instability gives you nonlinear spiral arms. Those arms can further fragment to form clumps, but then the clumps are driven inward through gravitational torques and may eventually lead to a luminous outburst at the center. Okay, so the kind of models we're doing are in thin disk limits. So we have vertical structure, but they are in hydrostatic equilibrium, and we model the R phi evolution dynamically. And once you've formed the disk, you may have hydrostatic structure vertically, in which the heating and cooling is determined by PdV work and all the normal hydrodynamic processes, as well as the stellar irradiation that's put in based on premain sequence modeling from the time that the central object formed. The star itself is not modeled, it's within a sink cell, and so you've got like a 5 AU standoff radius, but most of the matter that goes in is presumed to go into the central star, and then you feed back the stellar irradiation and do a one-zone model for the temperature of the surface of the disk as well as the midplane. So you can get the midplane temperature through combination of the gas dynamics and the heating that's coming from the surface and through the irradiation. And then you also have surface cooling and a little bit of irradiation from the background just based on the ambient temperature of the cloud core. Okay, so we take some care to do the simplified thermal evolution there. Otherwise, it's hydrodynamic evolution in R and phi. It's a pre-main sequence track. And there's also, sorry, there is the accretion luminosity as well, if that's what you're asking. Yes, that's right. Thanks. Okay, so we can model this with the central sink and then put in a logarithmic grid so you have greater radial resolution near the center. And the azimuthal spacing is uniform, but of course you get better spacing in the inner region where the circumference is smaller. So we start from about 5 AU and move outward. And we can cover a large dynamic range of scales, with the innermost cell being a tenth of an AU. And this goes all the way to the cloud core edge at about 10,000 AU. And the advantages of this approach versus 3D, for example, which we'd all prefer to do 3D if we could, right, is with the simplification of doing R and phi and also having the sink cell, you're able to integrate for a large dynamic range of time as well. So you can capture the fraction, several half a million years or so of prestellar collapse, as well as millions of years of protostellar disk evolution after it's formed. So that's the strength. You know, you make one approximation, which you gain something back. Okay. If you try to do full 3D or try to resolve everything down to the stellar surface or close to it, you're probably stuck doing a very short time scale simulation. Okay, so these are our equations. I'm not going to go through these, but basically, the vertically integrated, so you're integrating mass you're solving mass continuity and momentum for surface density instead of mass density, instead of volume density, and this would be an integrated pressure. Then you've got the standard energy equation with these terms containing, in mathematical terms, what I described in the schematic slide of the simple treatment of the cooling at the surface and the absorption of stellar radiation.
Question about capacity. So,
please.
Bell and Lin assumes sort of interstellar dust sizes. Now,
right.
In the upper disk, that's not unreasonable.
Mm-hmm.
So my question, specific question is, well, how large is tau? So if tau is really large, mm-hmm.
then
it may not matter because whether there's some mid-plane region with larger particles.
Right, yeah.
But, the outer disk has dominated by the mid-plane, so it's necessarily different. Well, no, it depends. What matters here, especially is the irradiation, isn't it? Whether it's the self-generated luminosity, or am I missing something?
Yeah, it's a stellar irradiation, right?
Yes. Okay, so right. You're letting the stellar radiation be the disk.
Right.
And that's helping to control its...
Right. Right. Yeah.
It's scale height.
Right.
So all you need for that really is optical depth greater than one to a radial optical ray, right?
Right. Yes.
Which of course has this small geometric effect.
Right. Yeah. So I mean, it is optically thick in some regions, and certainly as you go further out, it wouldn't be. I can't give you the exact number range at this point. It's not in my head. We actually are, you reminded me, we're actually not using Bell and Lin in the latest paper. Which one are we using? Oh, I forget. But we have updated the opacities. But anyway, it's probably something we can talk about afterward, after I have a chance to think about and look those up. Okay, so we're starting with the prestellar core, and we start with the standard Bonnet-Rebert type profiles, flat central region, power law, outer region, and the angular velocity is very similar profile based on this result of constant specific angular momentum as a function of enclosed mass, which most all the prestellar collapse simulations seem to converge to. Okay, so this movie I've shown lots of times. I won't show it for long, but basically, this is the episodicity sort of you know, better than I can describe it. So if you look at the rate at which mass is falling into the central sink that's down here, so as you form clumps and they migrate in, when the sheared out clump reaches the center, there's a time of about 100 years when your accretion rate and therefore the luminosity are rising and then falling again. Okay, and this was a very simplified model. This is an old one, but it's the one for which we have the animation. The better models are the ones I've shown you earlier. But this gets across the basic idea that you get those excursions as these clumps come in and reach the central sink. And you're generally getting a dominance of m equals 1 type modes, just illustrated by these images. And so these are all images at a time when instability has just occurred, and you're not too far away from having a burst, that is, from having the clumps migrate to the center. So if there's one money slide, this is the money slide that kind of captures the whole idea, which is that your accretion rate will, of course, go up to some value of order 10 to the minus 6, or it could be even 10 to the minus 5, as soon as you form a central object. And then you might stay at some smooth value as long as the infall is not mediated by a disk. In our model, that takes a little bit of time because you have 5 AU standoff for the sink cell. In reality, the disk would form right away. So in reality, you wouldn't really even have this phase for hardly any time at all. But the idea is, as soon as you form the disk, now the disk has its own natural accretion rate, which can be much lower than the rate at which it's being fed. This is still the rate at which you're feeding the disk from the collapsing core. And so you have this mismatch of infall versus transport rate. And that essentially gets you down to a low rate, typically as much as the disk can normally transport. But then when you go into the gravitational instability and the clump formation signified here, then when the clumps come in, you've got the big burst of accretion. So the idea is that most of the time your disk looks like this. It's in a quiescent phase with low accretion rate. And you still have some weak spiral structure, some flocculent spirals. But if you capture the disk, if you capture an image just before the burst, it will look more like this. Chris?
When it is the bursting mode, what's the ratio of disk mass to solid mass?
It's a few times 0.1. Yes, I mean basically it's ultimately gravitational instability is really going to kick in when you can think of it many ways. Well, when Q is less than one, right? Well, you could even rewrite the Q less than one criterion as an equivalent criterion that the disk over star mass is less than Z over R. See, I've been in Canada enough to say Z. Yeah, so to the extent Z over R is 0.1, the two are roughly equal. Yes, Peter.
Can't do the math in my head, but you can tell me how massive is one of those clumps?
About 0.01 solar masses, 10 Jupiter masses.
What's the size scale?
They are actually essentially first hydrostatic cores. Okay, you've got your spiral arm clumping up and collapsing locally. These clumps then get some integrity when they get to the opacity limit. Okay, so when they become opaque enough to temporarily halt contraction, that's sort of where they are. So the opacity limit in a gas cloud, you know, standard composition, occurs at about 10 Jupiter masses. Okay.
Is this an adiabatic simulation?
No. Yeah.
It's kind of the radiation. But this is temporary capacity.
Right. Yes, that's true. It is important. And we also, what we don't have is second collapse or those kind of thermodynamics. So this is going to stay at this kind of size.
In this case, I think I understand why don't the clump form just planets?
By what?
Why didn't the clumps turn into planets if they are 10 Jupiter mass?
They could, but they're also migrating in. Right? And
they can open again.
That's right. They could. Right. And they do in some cases. So I'll get to that. I'll even show a case where that happens, okay? But I guess our result is that most of the time, they're in a very dynamic environment, and they get migrated, they migrate in faster than they can open up a gap and settle in. And then eventually they get sheared out when they get very close to the center. Okay? So again, this I often give this talk elsewhere, so this is too simple for you guys. But so basically, yes, it's all about Q less than 1 when you're going into the instability with the clumps, and you'll be stable in this regime. But of course, as many of you know, this is a very interesting regime right here. And so maybe one of the most interesting results is that you hang around in this marginally stable state for a relatively long time. Well, it varies across the disk. So it's fixed grid. Yeah, it's a fixed logarithmic grid. So we have a central sink of about 5 AU. But then the first cell is about a tenth of an AU, and then each one gets larger. And by the time we get to the edge of the core at 10,000 AU, it's quite coarse. Okay, so let's move on. So here's another way of looking at the result. This is the same kind of thing as I showed you earlier. It's a linear plot instead of a log-log plot, so it looks a bit different. But once again, you pick up a lot of accretion once you form the central object. You stay in some smooth value, which reflects the rate at which the envelope's falling on to the center, essentially C cubed over G. But then when you form the disk, you drop to the low value, with punctuated by bursts. And this just makes that argument about the Q value, right? So if you take an average Q, averaged over the entire disk, that's the red line, and here's the values for that. And you can see that it's inversely correlated with the bursts. So essentially, you can be at some stable value, say here, and then as more mass is accreting onto the disk, Q is falling. And then once you get below some critical value, which does turn out to be about 1, then you get the burst. Essentially, you form the clumps, and they quickly migrate in. There's not much of a migration time, not much that's visible. Well, it might form somewhere here, right? But anyway, there's some time in there you get the migration, and then you get the burst, and now Q rises again, you go to a stable disk, and then the process starts all over again, okay? And it's going to be more frequent early on and less frequent later on because you've got a faster rate of supply to the disk early on, you've got a lower rate of supply later on. You know, you can do some of the simple numbers in your head. I mean, if you're trying to create a clump every time of 10 to the minus 2 solar masses, and you're feeding in at 10 to the minus 6 solar masses per year in both per year, then it might take you 10 to the 4 years to create a new clump, right? So you can sort of see where it might be 10 to the 4 year kind of periods, or even less. It could be 10 to the 3 in this model, but something of that order.
Is Q value average over this, or
yes,
weighted by the mass?
It's actually an average of the region where you're in rough centrifugal balance, okay?
Which is usually on the asteroid.
On the outskirts? Yeah. It's the entire disk. So most of the surface area is in the outskirts, right? But we've averaged over the entire disk. Okay. So yet another way to look at it, again, if you overplot, this is a slightly different model, but same qualitatively, if you overplot the envelope accretion, it's certainly correlated that once that drops below the rate at which the disk can naturally move mass, then you lose the bursts, okay? So this is like Lee Hartman's sketch that I showed earlier, but with a real calculation. Okay, so the basic idea, of course, behind the migration is that once you've got the nonlinear spiral arm and you've got your clump, the clump is being torqued up by the leading part of the arm and torqued down by the trailing part of the arm, and those give you two different torques. But basically, the trailing arm is generally going to have most of the mass, and that's what wins out and robs angular momentum from the clump. So it's a very natural process. If you've got a self-gravitating disk, that's a few tenths of the central object mass, you'll have enough self-gravity to make the arms in the first place. And then that gravitational interaction between the arm and the clump will drive the clumps inward. OK, so it is possible to open up a gap. So when we run enough of these models, and you know, honestly, no one has a theoretical or empirical function for exactly what the input angular momentum is in a prestellar core, right? So you can run these with various different ratios of rotational to gravitational energy. This model is about 10 to the minus 2, which is a relatively high number for a prestellar core, but not out of league. And roughly one solar mass core. Yes, Chris.
Awesome.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay, right. So this is a more dynamic model, okay, than typical. Although it's hard to say what typical is. So it's only non-typical based on the models that we ran. So this is really the big unknown observationally, exactly what the distribution is. But with these kind of parameters, you'll get a very dynamic disk early on. And most of the clumps will indeed migrate in, as they do in all other models. But in some situations, in some cases, in some realizations, I should say, you will get the last clump to survive long enough and become massive enough to carve out a gap. So basically, indeed, its hill radius does exceed the local scale height. And this clump manages to carve out enough of a gap to actually settle into a stable orbit. So notice the big gap in time here. Okay, in the last two panels. These are all times after the central object formed. What is that exactly? Sorry, this?
Yeah, the distance.
The distance, yeah, okay, it's coming. Yeah, it's about 50 AU, okay? So that here's the distance. So this is the position and mass of this object versus time. So radius was initially moving around a lot. There was a lot of inward and even outward migration as you had all these multiple clumps interacting. But then you settled into this 55 or so astronomical unit orbit. And the mass in this case, depending on whether you're looking at you know, some inner region or also some rotating matter of its own, is anywhere between 5 and 10 Jupiter masses. Okay, so this is definitely, you know, corresponding roughly to those wide orbit planetary mass companions I showed earlier. So this can happen. It's possible to carve out a gap and have companions. In principle, this is probably the mechanism by which you even form multiple star systems. Our model actually is actually discouraging disk fragmentation to some extent by having the central object fixed. It can't be pushed off center, which would be a good way for the neighboring clump to survive in a stable orbit. But even with that disadvantage, we do get companion object formation.
But yes? If you predict, if you want to form a stellar companion, that once you form that seed,
it would have to grow.
It would have to grow significantly by accretion.
That's right.
So it does, you shift the accretion center off from the main initial center of mass and then.
Mm-hmm. Right, yes, exactly, right. That would both help the secondary object to survive in orbit as well as accrete more mass.
Okay, but then that leads to the question. I mean, you can observe single stars in several stages of evolution. Wouldn't this make a clear prediction about the relative ages of a star and its, say, a subdominant stellar companion, in the sense that you might form the primary first and then second star might be delayed by a mega year or something like that, relative ages? So.
Yeah, but I mean, most binaries you're seeing are on the main sequence, right? So,
of course.
So can you detect such a...
Find lots of premium sequences.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, I mean... The mass accretion rate has gone down to the point that not only do you have the mass left to build yourself, you have to do it early.
Yeah, if you want equal mass companions, right? On the other hand, most stars are M stars, so maybe you can explain a lot of them, but not the more equal mass ones. Good questions. Don't know. Okay, so you can also get ejections. Okay, that's the other thing. Again, you need a model with relatively large amount of angular momentum. Again, beta is about 10 to the minus 2 here. And so that's for the initial prestellar core at 10,000 AU. And again, you get the multiple fragments interacting. But in this case, the three or multi-bodies clump model can also give you an ejection, right? For the same reasons as you'd get it with point masses, but it's a much weaker effect. You're scattering fuzzy things off each other that are AU scale. And so the ejection speeds are less. They're more like a kilometer per second. But it's an interesting new window into ejections, I think. I mean, the early disk phase, which of course we can't really observe very much till date, may be a source for a significant number of ejections. If you really have that many multiple clumps moving around, you may be able to eject low mass objects, which could be low mass stars, brown dwarfs, giant planets, going into a free floating state. Again, it's hard to quantify the number because we don't yet have a handle on what the initial conditions are, right? And of course, these models are also preserving angular momentum, right? So, there's a question as to how much you lose through magnetic fields and so on. Perhaps you're not losing a lot. Anyway, that's another issue, another problem. Yes, Peter.
Back to your couple of slides to when you had quarks happening.
Yeah.
Trying to recall the first movie that you showed.
Right.
It almost looked like that's often used to describe, say, migration or something, where. So, get to my question. Does the thing that's migrating in stay within something you would call a spiral feature, or does it even? Even with Ruby, it sort of looked like beads moving along the string.
Yeah, well, the arms themselves are migrating in the sense that the outer arm is gaining angular momentum and moving outward, the inner arm is losing it and moving inward. And
so it doesn't move into the gap between the arms.
No.
It didn't look like that.
No. Yeah, no, I don't think so. You're right. I think it's a smooth progression. Yeah, I mean, it depends on how smooth you want the arm to be. Yeah, but it's definitely got structure. Good point. Okay, so maybe I'll skip over some of these. How am I doing for time? Okay, right, so this is more about the ejections. It's to show we ran many models, and many of them had ejections. Wherever you have a dip in the total mass of the system is a case where a clump actually left the system. It was ejected. And some models actually had two ejection episodes. So they do happen over a wide range of models. You're typically getting a kilometer per second ejection.
So this
Yes. Well, this is the total model. So this is the whole prestellar core. And so the ejection is from the core entirely.
So some radius threshold, what are you saying? Total mass.
Yeah, well, essentially we have an open boundary, so matter that leaves the system can do so. Okay. All right. So about a kilometer per second ejection speed, it means that brown dwarfs or other objects that are ejected from a cluster are probably not going to leave the cluster within a few million years. They have the same ejection speed as the random motions in the YSO cluster. So this was a point people were trying to observe brown dwarfs at large distances from clusters under the assumption that they were ejected at high speeds, and no one found any, I think. But if it's a low velocity ejection, they would still be co-located with the parent cluster for a few million years, given that a kilometer per second is a parsec per million years, right? Okay, I'm going to skip this one. It's pretty much showing that as you go up the chain of more core mass or more beta, rotational to gravitational, you're more likely to get fragmentation and ejection, so you're sort of moving this way. But anyway, there's only a limited number of models in play here, but it shows that trend. And so I really want to just point out that what we're getting at here, back to the core accretion model, is that for the more massive objects that core accretion model might try to explain, you can alternatively have them form through gravitational instability in the disk. And that mechanism can also be a mechanism for forming brown dwarfs, as well as low-mass stars. And then as you go from brown dwarfs to stars, again, for a low-mass star, again, you have these two mechanisms again, but different ones. You can have a low-mass star from direct collapse or from gravitational instability in a disk, perhaps followed by ejection. Now, back to the disk models. So here's where it does get kind of interesting. Sorry, yes, please.
So there's not much data around the Western desert.
Yeah.
Right? Normally the IMS is a log normal or broken problem for stars.
Right.
And then there's another
that's going down.
One that goes up for planets.
Right, okay.
There's not an obvious feature in between, but maybe just because the things are looking at.
Right, right.
So I mean, this sensor is positing effectively a third mechanism in my perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the desert has to do with the companions around solar systems. It's not an absolute mass function. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, but you still have the IMF, if you like, extended down, just going down. There's not a feature. Or whether that's.
Mm-hmm.
It might be there. Not obviously, the probably because people have to look, it's hard to see these things, right?
Right.
Because they're not around stars, as you say, so you don't find it by reflex.
Right.
And then they're
dim. Right. Right. I guess I'm not certain that the idea that you'd have to see another signature.
I'm not sure you'd have to, right?
Yeah.
You might hope would be competitive with the other two. Mm-hmm. In which case you should see something.
Mm-hmm.
If it doesn't.
Right.
If you don't see anything, then you'd say, well, it's less common than these other
two. Right.
Even that mass range where it might be.
Right. Right. Yeah, possibly. Right. Now, what if the M stars themselves are mostly being made through disk?
Through
this ejection mechanism. Right?
Then you worry about why don't you see sort of a feature in the IMF, the small mass side of the IMF?
Mm-hmm. Right. You don't see it in the IMF. You do see it in multiplicity, for what that's worth, right? The M stars are more likely to be single. And that could be partially because they've been ejected from what was a multiple system. But yeah, that's a different thing. So
the everything on the low side was the result of fragmentation. It was capable of building things up from ground with masses towards the peak. Then
well, that's the inverse of fragmentation. Well, first you fragment
Well, it's true. The peak of the IMF is not. There's no clear theory for that, right? And so, I guess it could be kind of a separation between processes. Okay. Yes. Please. Right. Yes.
Is that related to how fast the clump is cooling and shrinking? If the clump remains heated.
Mm-hmm. I think it's more related to the impact parameter, because it can only be there's a lower limit to the impact parameter for these ejections.
Well, but that's what you're saying. You shift your planets.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't miss it. Okay, right. Yes, you're right. You're right. You're right. Right, right. Yeah, it's true. If these objects quickly collapsed to stellar type dimensions, then the interactions would be different, right?
Larger impact parameters, and so you think only generally, but still, you think you do.
Yeah, that. They'd be less likely to come into contact, I guess, if they were smaller. But they would. That's right. That's right. Yeah, they would definitely have the potential to be ejected to high speeds at that point. Right. And but whether they would happen as frequently, not sure. Make sense? Mm-hmm. They could merge or they could scatter. So Right. But you're right. It's the collapse of smaller dimensions, certainly. I mean, one has to put in moving sinks. That's one thing one can do in the future. And then you're kind of at the other extreme. You're really treating these as points. Yeah.
Do you see any correlation between injection speed and spinning speed?
No, I don't think we measure the spin. No, we don't measure the spin. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's very hard to measure. The spin of the clumps? Yeah. Well, we haven't looked at that. Yeah, that's a good question, but yeah. There is, yeah, well, there's certainly even a mini disk around some of these objects. So there is rotational support, yes. Okay, so now, I don't know how much time I want to spend on this, but this is actually one of the deeper points in that if you look at the profiles of angular velocity, surface density, temperature, and Q value. And the temperature actually in this model is, this is an earlier model from 2007, so this is a barotropic equation of states. It's not as sophisticated as later models, but even in a model with stellar radiation, you might get slightly higher temperatures near the center, but roughly the temperatures are not varying nearly as much across the disk as the other, these quantities. Okay, so that's the main point here. So when you set up a disk, so this is the disk after it's formed, it's got a sharp edge, which is moving outward as angular momentum is being transported, as mass is being transported inward, angular momentum outward. But you maintain a relatively sharp edge, so it's now at, you know, some 60 AU or so. And you tend to get the same slope as the minimum mass solar nebula, r to the minus 3 halves. And that's for the very simple reason that you're maintaining yourself at a constant Q state. Okay, you kind of self-regulate to this uniform Q value, which is just marginally at or above critical value. Okay, so these are at times when you're not having a burst necessarily. So at that point, things are more violent. But you are over time from 0.2 million years to a half to 1.5 when the bursts have definitely stopped. You are maintaining this self-regulated Q value, and it is rising slightly, as you can see, but it's not going very high above the critical value, at least over this kind of time. And if you maintain the Q value roughly uniform, then of course you can understand why you get this profile if your angular velocity is something close to Keplerian and has that that dependence. So basically, these two quantities are what count, and the square root of the temperature term is a small effect. So then the important point is why you're self-regulating. And so that, I don't think I have a slide on that. No, I don't, yes.
Why is the temperature non-monotonic? Why does it seem to increase as it increases?
Yeah, sorry, actually, it's increasing as you get to essentially higher densities and compressions and shocks and so on.
Yeah, of course. But just in the inner disk, it seems to decrease.
Good point. Yeah, this is actually a result of the sink cell. So yeah, the inner sink cell actually results in this. So I wouldn't put a lot of stock in that at this point. So okay, so that, there is a region that, yeah, that is affected by the central sink because you don't have the pressure feedback from the matter that's in. Sorry? Yeah.
From the gas
you got. Right, exactly. Yeah. So that's a transition zone. That's numerical. Okay, so I'm not going to talk more about this Q state, but maybe people who want to talk about it later on, I can say a little bit about, if you ask me a question, why it tends to stay in this kind of state for a relatively prolonged period of time. And of course, that's what's driving that's what's driving the late accretion, right? So even this accretion is coming from something. And it's coming from the fact that you're maintaining this near critical state of the Q value, and you have fluctuations that are persisting long enough to give you some weak non-axisymmetric structure and driving accretion through gravitational torques. We don't have MRI, right? So I'm going to claim it's the swing amplifier effect. And it has to do with the edge, okay? That you actually have a way to take trailing arms, reflect them off the edge, come back as leading arms, and as they unwind, you temporarily get a little bit of amplification. So that's...
That argument applies as the disk gets wider and wider, that argument sort of stops applying in regions that are far away from the region. So mm-hmm. that argument sort of applies globally to the stratification of the entire disk. You're seeing Q being roughly constant all the way across this point.
True, true.
So if that
right.
continued.
Right. Yeah. Well, it'd have to disperse eventually. But as long as you maintain a relatively sharp edge, and so the disk, you can think of it another way, it's not so viscous. Like if you put in some alpha constant thing, it might spread out quickly. But you know, the weakness of alpha model is the same everywhere. But in this kind of situation, it doesn't seem to be spreading out. And you're definitely driving a lot of fluctuations in this region, yes, but not here. But this is where most of the mass is, right? And so then you are still sending matter inward from that region.
Does it also mean that the insulation in the mainstream should be not only as good as one state?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can in a shearing sheet. Yeah, sure. Then you're looking at one, yeah, one region. Right, right. Right. I don't know how long they do this for, though. Right. I mean, so here, I mean, you're maintaining it for millions of years, and so I think, yeah, I would claim maybe they can't do it for that long. I don't know. Okay. Okay, so I want to skip this one in the interest of time. I want to get to some of the new, or even this is not the newest, but okay, so I'll say a little bit. This is all very quick. This is not stuff I know a lot about, but thermally processed materials. These missions like Deep Impact came back and found silicates that were in crystalline form as opposed to the expected amorphous form, and that implied that at some point when they were forming, the temperature would have been roughly above 800 Kelvin. Okay, so the idea that if you're forming these these lattices and you have enough thermal energy at play, the lattice has enough freedom to readjust to find the lowest energy state and settle in. Whereas if it's a lower temperature, you don't have enough freedom and you settle into this not the ideal state, which is the amorphous one. So how do you explain matter that was in the outer solar system having gone through this phase? Of course, there's many explanations, but one of them in the context of migrating embryos, as Edward Vorobyev pointed out in 2011, is that if you had these embryos that were migrating for 10,000 years or so, by the time they finally dispersed or fell all the way in, even in which case they're dispersing toward the end, they would have formed, they would have had an interior temperature because of their mass that was briefly or for some time above 800 Kelvin or so. And so just putting in some very simple formula for the crystallization rate, he could come up with the crystalline silicate fraction as a result of being in the interior of these cores. And then even if the core dispersed, you've got some remaining crystalline fraction. So this is one application, how migrating embryo idea applies to other contexts. And then Sergei Nyakshin has taken this even further and proposed that a migrating clump, if it lives for 10 to the 4 years, might actually have enough time to sediment solids to the center. And therefore, when it does finally move in and disperse, partially to give an inner gas giant, but even if it disperses fully, might give you a solid core that is giving you a head start on terrestrial planet formation. So this is another way of maybe solving timescale problems and using the rapid migration of outer solar system material where you have a lot of mass. So in the extreme form, of course, then gravitational instability also helps form terrestrial planets. So I'm not advocating this necessarily, but it's an interesting application of of this whole idea, and a lot of work to be done. So I want to talk about more recent stuff, going to the other end of the universe, about how you can use bursts to understand first generation of stars. And it was worked out many years ago that, unfortunately, if you look at the simplest scenario for first star formation, even pop three stars with 300 solar masses would probably not be visible by JWST if they were forming at redshifts of up to 30. And so this is in the context of this idea that pop three stars formed in isolation and that they were very massive. But even a 300 solar mass, so this is from Brahm et al, pop one and pop three, 100, 200, 300, even a 300 solar mass star is below 10 million solar luminosities, well below. And of course, going from pop one to pop three doesn't seem to gain you much luminosity at all. It's pretty much a straight line over. You go to a hotter state, you have a more contracted state without the CNO cycle initially, and you can also see deeper into the photospheres at a deeper level if you don't have the metals with the lower opacity. So you can get higher temperature, but not necessarily higher luminosity. So in a... For the photospheric luminosity? Not sure. Yeah. I could. I guess that's where you might end up. You essentially contract further, right? So you get that luminosity. Okay. So in pop one star formation, of course, we know that stars form in clusters. There's never an isolated one, and the simplest explanation, zero order one, is of course that you're dealing with star-forming nurseries that are many, many, many genes masses, and so it's hard to form a single star. And even in the POP3 standard scenario, if you look at the estimated masses of dark matter halos at redshift of 20 or so, and you use some of the standard numbers of 10% baryonic to dark matter ratio, you're still getting genes masses that are at the temperature set by molecular hydrogen, you're still getting genes masses that are somewhat less than the amount of matter you might have in play. So it seems like you're really missing out on something if you think POP3 stars only had to form in isolation. And so we pursued this idea that maybe they're forming in clusters, at least, you know, looking at this ratio, at least 10 to 20 to be conservative. And then you can run your burst model with a primordial gas, primordial temperature density relation. This is barotropic again for simplicity, but with the primordial relation between pressure and density. And so now you're starting with a much larger core based on your ambient genes mass and a much higher starting temperature. And we run these models, now it's barotropic, it's without the radiative feedback, so we only run it for the first 40,000 years, which is thought to be the time prior to when the H2 region will blow away the envelope. So we stop the calculation before H2 region becomes a dominant effect. But even in that first 40,000 years, if you run these models, you again get bursts, but everything's scaled up. So your base rate, with the orange is kind of a running time average, your base rate is about 10 to the minus 3 solar masses per year, and your peak rate is 10 to the minus 1 solar mass per year. And once again, you're sending most of the matter into the central sink, which is the star mass, and your disk mass is maintaining itself as some smaller but significant fraction of the central mass. But now everything's scaled up. The disk mass is quite high. And it's, if anything, more unstable, much more unstable than the present-day scenario. And so the important point is that in these kind of disks, about 30% of the accretion history is spent in a burst mode, in a burst, as opposed to the current-day models where it's more like 10%. So if such a large fraction of time is spent in the high state, or you know, on the way up or on the way down, then a cluster of even 10 to 20, let's say 16, has at any time in the early history of the cluster, assuming they're roughly coeval, at any time you can have several objects in a burst mode. And so you can get a kind of a multiplier effect. And what we found is that even relatively low mass POP3 stars, like these are all 40 solar masses or less, can collectively rise to about 10 to the 8 solar luminosities for a brief period, if you get just the right kind of overlap of the different bursts. So our basic result is that even if POP3 stars are modest, which is the latest thinking, with now with the radiative feedback, people have gone away from thinking about 300 solar mass stars to thinking more like 40 or so. But even a small, so that would be worse for JWST, right? But even a small cluster of 40 solar mass or less stars can be transiently much more luminous than even the single 300 solar mass star. Okay, so there's some, I think there's some hope. You know, you never know. Usually you see a lot more with these new instruments than you ever expected, right? So I think one shouldn't be too pessimistic about seeing POP3 stars, or some people claim they already have, right? So maybe you don't need JWST. But I think first stars should, you know, it's unlikely, theoretically, that they would be in a single environment, not in a cluster environment. And so the early phase might be a time to catch them in a very bright state. Okay, so this is the last slide. So I know I'm maybe running a bit late. So this is, again, kind of speculative stuff. So because of these recent observations of very supermassive black holes at high redshift, high enough redshift that you're talking, you know, less than 900 million years after the Big Bang, if you actually have billion or even 10 billion solar mass black holes, it's a problem for people who work in that field as to how to get them to be so massive at such an early time. And you're basically having to accrete at the Eddington rate for the entire time since the Big Bang, essentially, and then you're barely getting there. So one of the ideas suggested by Avi Loeb and Volker Braun was that you just start from the supermassive cloud. You set up a state where the genes mass is 100,000 solar masses. So that's even more than the POP3 genes mass of a few hundred solar masses. So the idea is you need to raise the temperature up to 10,000 Kelvin or more. And so this idea is a speculative idea, right? So the idea here is that you form your POP3 star the normal way. So no one's yet observed, but OK, the normal way that's thought. And then you send out enough ultraviolet photons to dissociate DH2 in the nearby gas. And so this is now population 3.1. And that gas is now at a very high temperature because it's lost its primary coolant. It's purely atomic gas. And at this very high temperature, the genes mass is 10 to the 5. And so, okay, so now you have a 10 to the 5 solar mass object collapse. And of course, it's very simple-minded in that it's not clear, of course, that a single object that big would actually monolithically collapse into one object, right? And so that's not really been explored in great detail. But it's interesting that this paper, which came out earlier this year, said, well, what would happen if that accretion happened in a bursty way? And you were accreting onto this central seed, not at the C cubed over G rate that would be implied by this, but rather with a disk, as you would expect all star formation would have a disk. But you're accreting at a low rate most of the time, and occasionally going up into a high rate, and therefore still preserving the average rate that you would otherwise expect. And so their point is, if you actually accrete at the low rate for long enough time, longer than some critical period, then your star actually doesn't, your central star doesn't expand the same way it normally would if you had this rapid accretion while it's forming. And so if you actually allow the star to undergo this Kelvin-Helmholtz contraction, because it has a very low accretion rate for long enough periods, it might actually get to a very small radius and high temperature and therefore give a lot of ultraviolet feedback and form an H2 region that could blow away the envelope. So again, it's a lot of speculation here. This is why I'm ending with this kind of stuff. But yeah, that's a good point, right? You're not really overpressured much at all, right? So they actually didn't do that calculation, right? This is purely a stellar evolution calculation with some you know, by hand bursts put in. So anyway, this is all sort of like what people are debating in this field, but it's an interesting application of this idea of bursty accretion. Okay, so that's it. Basically, I think I've gone through the various aspects of our migrating embryo model, and you know, more and more flaky applications, I guess. But you know, the basic idea is that you're going to be relatively unstable in this zone, and you'll form the clumps of 10 Jupiter masses or so initially, and then they migrate in for thousands to 10,000s of years. Mostly, you know, it's the mass accretion burst that we were trying to explain originally. Most clumps will move inward and be sheared out and bring a big load of mass accretion to the center. But you can occasionally open up a gap and form a companion, as we know happens in nature. And you can also have ejection of clumps in some cases. And these could explain some freely floating brown dwarfs or giant planets. And then there's various applications going on, both on the planetary side and even in the POP3 side of what clumps and bursts would mean. Okay, thank you.
Well, question about the mass of your objects.
Please.
So in the first order of things, you have h bar squared times, or h squared times with this surface density is a first estimate of the clump mass. And then how exactly does that evolve from that?
The clump mass itself?
Yeah. So you were talking about the opacity of the fragmentation. Mm-hmm. Some downsizing that takes place in your calculation after that?
It doesn't in our model. So once you form this first hydrostatic core, it can be, it's roughly a first hydrostatic core. It can be sheared apart eventually as you move it in toward the center. Okay, and so it has some integrity. You know, it's kind of held together as at least a quasi-hydrostatic object. It doesn't have the ability in our model to undergo a second collapse to stellar dimensions, or you know, or planetary, if you like. So
roughly speaking, you reduce the disk aspect ratio, then you would reduce the mass of the clumps you're forming.
If you reduce the aspect ratio of the disk,
yes,
h over r. Okay. Yes, you would. That would mean you have a lower mass disk. Well, you'd certainly get less clumps. Well, if you weren't gravitationally unstable, you wouldn't get any clumps at all, right?
If you have a similar key, you get more clumps. You
get r over h squared clumps, too.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so okay, right.
You get more smaller clumps.
You get more smaller ones, yeah. If that was, yeah.
The radiation transfer doesn't allow you to do more. Well, this fragments on size is smaller than the capacity of the material. It's just not possible to avoid so fast.
There's a lot of factors. If you're you need a different thermodynamics, yeah, to get smaller masses.
You mentioned this connection possibly with the spiral arms seen in this co-pensure disk.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way of confirming those are really caused by?
Well, I think. Well, I think that's the next step. We actually start modeling those objects, right? I don't know who has. Maybe some people have started, but. Yeah, I think that's the next big thing, to see if you can model those images with gravitationally unstable disk, which might be the most obvious place to start. Or, you know, there's always the idea of companions causing spiral arms, but it seems, flybys, right? But it seems unlikely if you're seeing this many, right? If you're seeing them that commonly. Not necessarily. No, I mean, there will be some period afterward where you still have some arm structure. And even, even in the quiescent phase, you've got weak structure, right? So the key is, as you said, how do you convert this, which is actually gas density, into scattered light off of dust. So so that's the modeling that needs to be done, right? And off the surface too, right? So so I'm not claiming this is the explanation, but it could be that these spiral features are significantly enhanced in the scattered light somehow, right?
If you look at a sub-millimeter, you might have enough. Your optic could fit probably out of 150 AU.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Then you just do it from the column density of the dust,
essentially. Right, right. Yeah, that would be the way to do it. But I think you're not getting such...
That's what I'm saying, if you use Ohm, that's what you
want. Right, Ohm is the way to do it, right.
So then you need to know something about the relative strength. Light you get.
No, it's mostly. I mean, there's some, yeah.
But what if you found a big grand spiral disk which has no envelope, no cores anymore? Is that insane? Meaning it's not fed by anything?
Well, no, I wouldn't expect to see this. No. No. Not like that, no. Right? But yeah, you have to see a lot of them. I guess for any single object, you can argue, well, you just saw it right after, right after something happened. Yeah.
If you saw that with ALMA, you would probably figure that there's something wrong with your observations.
It's too good to be true.
No, not anymore. It's just
an
HL tower, right?
Well, that's true, right? Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah.
Well,
the surprise is, yeah, I mean, if you asked me to guess, I would have expected you'd see this. But yeah, you see the nice circles. So yeah, that implies planets, I guess, in HL tau. Yeah.
There's a few numerical constraints that are affecting the results, right?
So sure.
You mentioned the fixing the central object in place. There's also the radiation transfer you didn't actually do to the radiation temperature.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I think the most important one that Yin Shin has alluded to is the fact that, you know, in the case of these interactions between embryos,
right,
you get ejections, the speed depending on their physical radius. But that also affects their ability to be tidally destructive as they move in, right?
Yes, so, that's right.
So
yes.
That's all happening. Condensing down to the grid scale,
right,
and then as
right.
you move in, that's a different scale as you move in, so you get to condense a little bit more.
Right, right.
And then at some point, maybe that doesn't keep up with the local tidal shear.
Right.
So, but do you know if they should contract slowly enough that actually happens?
Well, it's a good question. Yeah, so that's kind of like what we're kind of hoping to do in the future. And of course, one can try and do sinks and all that. So there is a paper by Tsukamoto et al., the group in Japan with Inotsuka and others. And they've done some disk simulations. It's 2014 or 15. And they're claiming that these first cores do collapse within 1,000 years or so, right? So which is similar to how a core at the center would if it had a lot of matter falling in. These ones don't, so there's been a bit more of a question as to whether they would survive longer. Okay, so there is that suggestion now out in the literature that maybe these also collapse relatively quickly, in which case, yes, this will be a different evolution, right? These things
so
that have...
So the evolution is, the radial evolution is determined mainly by hydrogen dissociation, not by radiative losses.
Well, I mean, the hydrogen dissociation would be the factor that changes their size significantly, okay? And that's what will enable them to, if they become compact, right? To survive against tidal shearing and you know, even the ejection thing would be different as well. But I think it's that being sheared apart that is, you know, one thing that ultimately kills these objects, right? Even if they,
so
they migrate in.
Their mean density has to go down more slowly than the average density of the stuff inside, because they started off at around Q equals 1.
Mm-hmm.
And they contract a little bit within.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to get tidal disruption, you have to arrange that ratio of densities to have a turnaround.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I'd have to think about that. I mean,
The canon is object of form, and it's sharing bits. The canon is lost, and it's sharing momentum. That makes it even worse.
Yeah, but they can undergo local gravitational instabilities as well. If their rotation was supported, their gravitational unstable, they should shed angle. That's how you want to start.
Yeah, they're all this.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? We should probably get some quick.
Okay, good stuff. Thank you.